In Stockholm, there is a team that loves to get up for a game with Canada. For the Swedish nationals, there is something to prove, because they often trail the more powerful hockey nations. Börje Salming is one of the players on the ice tonight who is destined for the NHL. So is Inga Hammerström. They are among the first Europeans who will play in North America. With the eyes of NHL scouts looking on, Team Canada endeavors to improve their game by stepping into another culture. The exhibition final comes at a rough time for Team Canada. With the two games having no impact on the Soviet series, the Swedes are greeted with a cavalier attitude.
Vancouver felt like it was the bottom. Stockholm was. Now, these were the intervening games. These were the games that didn't count. Canadian teams aren't very good at playing games where they don't really count.
Despite handily taking the first game 4-1, the Canadian style is an easy target for the referee's whistle. They're among the last to realize what the Europeans know. Get the Canadians' emotions up and take advantage of the power play. Already having to deal with the rejection from Canada, the blood runs close to the surface. Furthermore, the players have to deal with a tactic they're unaccustomed to in the NHL game. Europeans are renowned for discreet spearing with the stick, elbows, sometimes even spitting. It is felt but rarely seen, even by prying television cameras. The welts, bruises, and cuts are shared by all. Wayne Cashman's series is about to come to an end in one such play, as he takes a Swedish stick in the mouth.
The guy turned and speared me in the face, and it cut my tongue. You know, I could have did the same thing, marched around the arena and showed it off or anything, but, you know, it's very little was ever said about it. And I had a very bad cut. I was out for the rest of the series because of it.
One thing that can be said of the Canadians, they keep score and usually find their moment for payback. Though they'll turn many against them, they discover strength in standing up for each other. The bond grows through adversity, even when it boils over for public view.
We loved them beating on us because we knew we were going to be treated like that anyway. Better them than our own people, because we expected it. As a matter of fact, we wanted it. And it got us back to, hey, let's play hockey. We don't have a responsibility to answer to anybody else. This is how we play hockey, and let's go play it. We play it rough and skillful.
And Canadians play hockey with creativity, ready to come through when the moment counts. But often there's a price to pay. The European referees find cause to clamp down, just to even things up. Calls are made with little regard for how slight a possible infraction might be. The home crowd eggs them on with disapproving whistles. The predictable result contributes to the spectacle. As the penalty minutes get recorded, they tell their own story. The Canadian players come to realize the game is preparing them for more than just conditioning and a bigger ice surface. A different standard of refereeing can be anticipated.
It was as bad as I've ever seen, and we knew then the refereeing wasn't going to be any better. In Russia, it would be worse in Moscow. So we had a decision to make.
The decision is to stay united. It is the only hope remaining for Team Canada. Maintaining composure is essential. Games can't be won from the penalty box. Although for some, crossing the line is easier than imposing self-restraint. Vic Hadfield's bloody cross-check to Sweden's captain will be on the front pages of the next day's papers. It's all that's needed for the international and Canadian press to further prove the points they've written. Canada's ambassadors of hockey are goons. The outcry leaves the team isolated. Just as they're beginning the journey behind enemy lines, no one wants to be associated with a team that displays such flagrant disregard for the principles of the sport.
The papers there called us gangsters. Our own ambassador there had unkind words for us. We learned that we really have to depend on each other, that everybody maybe had written us off, you know, weren't too happy with us, but the only ones we could depend on was each other.
It is almost impossible to envision what could help resurrect a team from such apparent disarray. At least they were at the bottom together.
You get a lot of pride, those athletes get a lot of pride, and most of the time it happened on a regular basis. You have to go down, really down, before you can go up, and when you have a crisis like that, I guess the players, they all get together and they rebound, and that's what happened.